From Lagos, the nation's commercial capital, this is the News at 10. Live from Channels Television, reporting tonight, Millicent Walker.
Hello and welcome. Tonight, renowned writer Chimamanda Adichie graces Nigerian Bar Association conference, says Nigeria is a nation in search of heroes after Professor Dora Akunle and Gani Faomi left the stage, challenges the NBA to fill the vacuum. Fireworks at the NBA conference as 2023 presidential candidates lock horns. Obi gets tumultuous welcome. Atiku explains his agenda. Tinubu is absent. Nigerian Civil Aviation Authority dismisses allegations of sales of flight tickets in US dollars as Minister of Information and his team inspect new Terminal 2 building at the Murtala Mohammed International Airport, Lagos. And Lagos government set to wield the big stick gives a 7-day eviction notice to owners and residents of the Bariga collapsed building, seals another building considered structurally defective.
On business news tonight, the National Bureau of Statistics says prices of food items in the country rose in July amid high energy costs.
On sports news tonight, Nigeria Professional Football League side Shooting Stars of Ibadan unveil former manager Gbenga Ogunbote as the new head coach of the team ahead of the 2022-2023 season.
And from Abuja, hope for safe schools rekindled as the federal government prepares to launch national policy on financing safe school projects in the country.
And in international news from London, President Volodymyr Zelensky warns that Russia could do something particularly ugly ahead of independence celebrations on Wednesday.
Nigeria. That seems to be the question on the front burner at the 2022 annual conference of the Nigerian Bar Association, where award-winning author Chimamanda Adichie said that Nigerians are starved of heroes whom citizens can look up to. Adichie, who gave the keynote address at the event, noted that the nation is currently in disarray with things getting harder by the day, pointing out that citizens cannot be safe where the rule of law is absent. According to her, the NBA is in position to give the country heroes whom Nigerians can look up to lead the nation going forward. The opening day of the conference also had some presidential candidates addressing the gathering of lawyers. It's the 62nd Annual General Conference of the Nigerian Bar Association, NBA, the leading event of the NBA and a main feature of the annual calendar of the legal profession in Nigeria. A major highlight of the conference is the presence of the vice presidential candidate of the All Progressives Congress, the presidential candidate of the People's Democratic Party, the African Democratic Congress, the Social Democratic Party, the All Progressives Grand Alliance, and that of the Labour Party, who received a rousing welcome when he was introduced.
Peter Obi, CON of the Labour Party.
The array of distinguished guests, including politicians, members of the bar and the bench who converged on Lagos, sims in tandem with this year's theme, Bold Transitions.
The annual conference is our flagship event, and the historical successes of previous conferences have made the AGC a permanent fixture in the NBA calendar that notably brings together distinguished public figures, thought leaders, and captains of industry to interrogate crucial issues in law, business and governance.
In a room filled with bright minds and learned fellows, The atmosphere goes a notch higher when the keynote speaker, Chimamanda Adichie, takes to the stage.
We are starved of heroes in this country. So many young people are hungry for figures that they can look up to, for examples of integrity. One of my Nigerian heroes is Dr. Dora Akunyili, the late, may she rest in peace, may she continue to rest in peace, the late former Director General of NAFTAC, who was also considered troublesome. Troublesome meant that she, among other things, fought the importation of fake drugs into Nigeria, that she tackled the substandard status quo of the food and drug industries, and by so doing, she saved and changed many Nigerian lives.
On the 2023 elections, the author urges the NBA to act as the nation's collective conscience, as anything short of an accountable process will not be in the best interests of Nigerians.
As the Nigerian Bar Association continues to challenge the abuses of power, it is also important to turn inwards and reflect on how to avoid being co-opted structure of the abuse of power.
The Attorney General of Lagos reminds members of the legal profession about the multiple roles they play in society as arbiters.
The work that you do as legal practitioners impacts all of us and the quality of our lives in countless ways. This means that you carry a great responsibility on your shoulders to continually be part of the critical mass that creates and sustains a better society, a just, peaceful, and prosperous one for all.
The NBA conference continues till Friday, August the 26th, when a new administration will be sworn in to handle the state of affairs of the association for the next 2 years. Some presidential candidates also took turns to address the gathering, highlighting what Nigerians should expect from them if elected to pilot the affairs of the country in 2023. For the vice presidential candidate of the All Progressives Congress, Kashim Shettima, who represented the party's presidential candidate, Bola Tinubu, the government of Asiwaju Tinubu will replicate the wonders in Borno and Lagos states if elected president in 2023. Labour Party's presidential candidate, Peter Obi, who received a rousing reception at the event, lamented the current state of the nation, saying the nation cannot afford to continue the same way. Similarly, the People's Democratic Party candidate, Atiku Abubakar, said the nation is experiencing all the negative indices, but the most important thing is how it can be tackled, identifying five key areas that need overhauling.
Today we have had all the negative indices as far as our country. Today we are more disunited as a nation. We have never experienced this level of poverty. We have never experienced this state of insecurity. We have never experienced this level of unemployment. We have recognized all these negative developments in our history.
We don't have the other tracks yet.
What is important is how do we tackle these challenges. And this is where history and also experience beckon on us to make sure that we don't get it wrong at this point in time. Otherwise, if we get it wrong at this point in time, I don't know when we will ever get it right.
For me, Nigeria needs urgent transition from being a highly insecure country to a secure country. From a disunited country to a united country, from corruption to a transparent country, from a country of lawlessness to a country of law and order. But in all this, it is important that we look at where we are today for people to understand the gravity of the journey we are going to take if we are going to transit.
What is important for a Nigerian leader of the next dispensation must be a leader who has a mastery of financial management capabilities and someone who understands the Nigerian psychology, someone who appreciates and understands the complexity of the Nigerian nation. Here, you have a city boy who has transformed Lagos into a home for all. My brother seated here, he calls Lagos home, not Awka. Ashwajibola Ahmed Tinubu has established an excellent track record of performance. He has mentored men and women who are excelling in different fields of human endeavor. And the world is changing. And the trajectory of global growth is facing Africa, and Nigeria will make or mar that transition.
Well, we'll have more of what other presidential candidates at the NBA conference of other political parties had to say a little later on. But staying with the NBA, the National Executive Council of the Nigerian Bar Association has ratified the suspension of Mrs. Joyce Odua as the General Secretary of the Association. The suspension was ratified late Sunday evening at the NBA NEC meeting, which is part of activities of the NBA Annual General Conference holding at the Accra Atlantic City, Lagos. On Monday, 15th August 2022, the national officers of the NBA had suspended the General Secretary pending the ratification of the NBA and NEC. 9 of the 11 officers who signed the resolution authorizing the suspension also resolved to refer her to the NBA National Executive Council for disciplinary action and to recommend her removal from office for gross misconduct. At the NBA NEC meeting, they considered the wise counsel of the elders of the bar, including past presidents and senior advocates of Nigeria, on the need to protect the unity of the bar and the legacies of the Olumide Akpata administration, and resolved that the suspension be ratified. Mrs. Joyce Odua therefore stands suspended as General Secretary, while Uche Nwadialo's appointment as Acting General Secretary was ratified. The petition for the removal of Joyce Odua from office was, however, stayed in view of the pendency of the court action on the issue. And to other stories, the Director General of the Nigerian Civil Aviation Authority, Captain Musa Nuhu, says the regulator is not aware of any airline selling tickets in dollars. This is coming on the heels of the foreign airlines' inability to repatriate money from ticket sales from Nigeria. Captain Nuhu said this during the visit of the Minister of Information, Mr. Lai Mohammed, to the new Terminal 2 at the Murtala Mohammed International Airport in Lagos.
About 13 million passengers traveled through Nigerian airports in 2021, representing a growth rate of 43.4% from the 9 million recorded in 2020. Of this figure, a total of 2.2 million foreign movements occurred, with many traveling through the Murtala Mohammed International Airport in Lagos. And now the new terminal at the airport in Lagos is where the Minister of Information comes visiting to take a look at the state of facilities. The check-in area, arrival concourse, and passport control are some of the minister's stops.
And we attend to them.
During the tour, the controller in charge of immigration at the terminal says the visa on arrival is a foreign exchange earner.
We found out that an average of 146 passengers pass through this place monthly, and we've generated well over close to $500,000 monthly.
When the tour is over, it's time for a press meet. The Minister of Information lost the terminal's facility as a testament to the present administration's investment in infrastructure.
I'm proud to say that no administration in the history of this country has done so much more with so little. This new international terminal was not built to replace Terminal 1. Rather, it was built to complement it.
While the issue of the foreign airlines' $464 million blocked funds in the country is causing ripples in the travel sector, the minister says relevant authorities are working on the issue. The Director General of the Nigerian Civil Aviation Authority adds that foreign airlines are not demanding dollar payments for tickets.
We are not aware of dollarization where people, where airlines have demanded for purchase of tickets in dollars. And we still follow with that, but we are not aware of any such. I have a personal experience this morning. I can show you the ticket right now. It sent to me, it was paid for in Naira.
In the coming days, the nation's position on the blocked funds will be tenable if foreign airlines threatening to leave confirm resolution of the matter and remain in the country. Bukola Joe Okitumbi, Channels Television News.
In part two after the break, House of Representatives Committee summons Managing Director of Transmission Company of Nigeria over Azure contract controversy. Please stay with us. Just joined us, you're watching the news at 10 live on Channels Television Lagos. A reminder of our top stories. Renowned writer Chimamanda Adichie speaks at NBA conference, says Nigeria is a nation in search of heroes. Fireworks at the NBA conference as 2023 presidential candidates lock horns. Obi gets tumultuous welcome. Atiku explains his agenda and Tinubu is absent. NCAA dismisses allegations of sales of flight tickets in US dollars as Minister of Information and his team inspect new Terminal 2 building at the Murtala Muhammad International Airport, Lagos. And Lagos government set to wield the big stick gives a 7-day eviction notice to owners and residents of the Bariga collapsed building, sells another building considered structurally defective. Back to our top story, the presidential candidates at the NBA conference today. The ex-Anambra State Chief Judge and presidential candidate of the All Progressives Grand Alliance, Mr. Peter Omeadi, he admonished on respect for the ballot and sustaining free and fair elections, while the presidential candidate of the Social Democratic Party, SDP, Adewale Adebayo, said there is a leadership crisis and that the statistics don't add up, while the candidate of the African Democratic Congress, Dumebi Kachiku, says solutions are desperately needed for the challenges the nation is facing.
Democratic transitions, which are transparent, will be the surest way to strengthen our country. Yeah. Nigeria, we should brace up for the best electoral practices in election year 2023 and beyond. In all modesty, I postulate that the triple banner of the rule of law, separation of powers, and due process will lead us to security of lives and property, economic revitalization, prosperity, and genuine happiness. Transitions cannot be rotations. Achebe was right that leadership was a problem of Nigeria. But the problem of Nigeria today is rotation of the same leadership in different political parties. If you make a change, a generational change, attitudinal change, you will have a bold transition that will take away all those who have been in government and bring new people
That is the vision.
We speak about security. I live in Abuja. My kids can no longer go to school because schools in Abuja, where the president of Nigeria lives, schools are shut. If they can't protect schools in Abuja, where then is safe in Nigeria? Where is safe in Nigeria? Our security infrastructure is overwhelmed, underfunded. We must immediately get the police. Please, it's important you listen to me. Please, please. We must immediately get the police, the civil defense to join our military in this war. I have been to war-torn countries, and Nigeria is the only country in the world where a nation is at war and her people don't know they are at war.
Well, we're off to Abuja, where my colleague Linda Akigbe is standing by with more. Hi, Linda. Happy New Week.
Hello, Millicent. Happy New Week, too. And now to other major stories. The House of Representatives Committee on Finance today dismissed officials of a transmission company of Nigeria, TCN, over their failure to answer critical questions concerning a $33 million take-or-pay agreement with a power generation company, Azura Power West Africa Limited. Now, during the continuation of the committee's investigative hearing in Abuja, the federal lawmakers questioned the figures contained in the presentation by the TCN management, insisting that the company's managing director and chief executive officer, Sule Abdulaziz, appears before the panel to answer queries.
It's the continuation of an investigative hearing by the House of Representatives Finance Committee on the planned sale of national power assets by the Bureau of Public Enterprises. At the hearing last week, the committee queried the $30 to $33 million per month pool call option agreement reached with investors on the Azura Power plant. The agreement stipulates that Nigeria is obligated to pay between $30 to $33 million monthly to Azura for power generated, whether transmitted or not, through the national grid by the transmission company of Nigeria, TCN. However, committee members had expressed displeasure at this agreement and invited the transmission company of Nigeria, TCN, to appear on Monday to give more details of the contract. But the managing director of the TCN was a no-show at Monday's hearing.
It's rather unfortunate. The MD will have found it worthy to even come here and take permission, maybe after consulting with us.
In the absence of the managing director of the TCN, the committee questions representatives of the company on the volume of electricity evacuated and transmitted from the Azura power plant.
Can you confirm if the 450 megawatts we signed with Azura has been produced and delivered to the grid on a monthly basis?
If you convert what they have been giving in the monthly basis, it has not been giving us exactly what was signed.
This document you gave us, there's no month that they have met 450, no month. You can refer us to a month where they met 450.
Between committee members are displeased at the computation of figures in the written presentation by the TCN management.
Now, see, did you sign an agreement? This agreement, is it megawatt hour?
So that was, sir, if you calculate it, you know. It's,
God. Okay, we have to send you away and ask your MD to come here, because you are not following us, you are not helping us.
Angered by the inability of representatives of TCN to give answers to critical questions, the committee dismisses TCN officials and insists that the managing director of the company must appear before members on Tuesday, August 23rd, to answer the queries and furnish members with more details of the pool call option agreement reached with investors on the Azura power plant.
As part of their measures to ensure a safe learning environment for students in the country, the federal government says the national policy for the financing of safe schools will be launched by September. This is coming from the permanent secretary in charge of special duties at the Ministry of Finance, Alhaji Shehu Shinkafi, who explains that the plan will incorporate the states and federal government to ensure adequate budgetary allocation, was speaking at a meeting on safe school financing in Abuja. Gunmen have killed a 47-year-old hotel owner, Kayode Akinyemi, and abducted his friend in Gamo, Ifelodun local government area of Kwara State. The manager of the hotel was also reportedly wounded and hospitalized. The assailants were said to have entered the hotel late last night and opened fire on Mr. Akinyemi and his friends. Still ahead on the news at 10, the National Bureau of Statistics says prices of food items in the country rose in July amid high energy costs. Join us again. Back to Lagos, where the state government has sealed the two-story building where a collapsed scaffolding has killed two persons in Bariga area of the state last night. Some residents of the affected building who were also handed an eviction notice are begging for more time. Our correspondent Timothy Crown, Adeyegbiwe, reports.
Last Sunday night ended in tragedy for residents of number 26 at Ileye Street in the Bariga area of Lagos State. Four members of a family were said to be taking a meal that would end up being the last for two of them, whom eyewitness said died on the spot from the impact of a falling defective scaffolding of a defective building.
I'm inside, my wife is inside. I just went out. As I went out like this, I don't know what came to me. I just said I should be. Went back. As I went back, I see my wife rush outside. That Jesus, Jesus. As I look back, I see every building already down. So, and I hear sound. Help me, help me, help me. One surviving girl. So, I need to use my hand to break those zinc that cover the girl so the girl can move out. So, when I went inside to see the people that are inside, see two persons already dead already.
The grief is obvious on neighbors who blame the disaster on this empty two-story building on another street. There are allegations that the falling structure was built on a septic tank that, in addition to poor construction work.
Nobody living inside this building, nobody have ever lived inside that building for good a year. All what they always complain when there's every breeze, the building always shake. That's why people... If you go inside the building now, nobody is living there for the past 4 months now. I later heard that the person that owned the building sold it out to another person due to the bad foundation.
Now the state government has sealed the defective building, and the residents of the affected building have also been given 7-day eviction notice.
My retired man, where would I go? This, if federal government can help us, or state government, or local government, for 7 days, where will we go? This, I'm begging them.
The falling tank and pillars still sit in the room from where the original occupants have been evacuated, perhaps permanently. For now, the surviving victims are said to be responding to treatment. Timothy Crown, Adiribibi, Channels Television News.
And we're off to Edo State, where private sector education seems to have received a boost with the commissioning of St. Matthew's Royal College in Edeno Uromi. Dignitaries from all walks of life were around to grace the occasion, which also witnessed the formal donation and commissioning of a police station and a barrack located at the entrance of the school to the Edo State Police Command.
St. Matthew's Royal College joins the ever-buzzing field of private sector participation in the education industry. It is a school that's firmly positioned as a game changer, located at Uromi in the northeast local government area of Edo State. Luxurious and serene environment, complete with modern facilities, computer laboratory, and entrepreneurship center in an ideal environment. High-tech classrooms with internet connectivity, including a library. comfortable and well-furnished dormitory. A well-equipped clinic is provided for students and staff. On the issue of security, the school donates a police station and a barrack to the Edo State Police Command.
Do hereby commission this project for the betterment of this community and the use of police in general. We thank God Almighty. Amen.
Then Bishop Ferbi Dahusa comes through with other dignitaries to officially commission the school.
I will declare this open in the name of God the Father, Amen. Son, and Holy Ghost, we pray. Amen.
The chairman of St. Matthew's Royal College speaks about the purpose of the school.
Because you have many people at stake. When you build a school, you build generation. When you build a school, student has a stake, the old boy has a stake, teacher has a stake, committee has a stake, the government has a stake, and your family has a stake. So for many, many years to come, education can never die. Business can die, education cannot die. Everybody has a stake on the education. As an adventure into education, not to make money.
The president, Honorable Briggs, sums it all up.
Get into our website and purchase your form. The resumption is 18th of September 2022. My website is www.stmatthewsroyal.com. When you get in there, the admissions are everywhere. Just click on apply and you are in.
For the owners of this school, St. Matthew's Royal College is a sure deal.
The Art of Living Foundation Nigeria, a non-profit educational and humanitarian organization, has held a roundtable with business leaders in Lagos with the theme Building Emotional Resilience. The meeting is one in a series of events marking the foundation's 2022 Culture Festival of Song, Music and Dance that seeks to promote peace, which appears to be a scarce commodity.
As the world grapples with heightened volatility and uncertainty, Art of Living, a non-profit organization, has put together a roundtable with business leaders in different sectors of the economy on how to build emotional resilience as part of its three-day culture festival for 2022.
Of what importance will that inheritance be?
Global Peace Ambassador and founder of Art of Living, Gurudev Sri Sri Ravi Shankar, says eliminating stress and fostering inner peace is the way to go.
You know, countries around the world spend billions and trillions on weapons. I would say even if they spend 0.1% of the national resource in educating people on peace, on values of nonviolence, the world would be a better place.
For society to strengthen their human capital, Gurudev also recommends meditation and catching them young.
From the childhood, we need to give them several exercises, several opportunity to express their softer side, softer skills, like compassion, helping, serving, instead of making them so self-centered all the time. Having a foothold on your wisdom, on your intellect, then emotions can make your life better.
The event was laced with musical arts, and Akshay Jain, director of Art of Living, highlights the important role businesses have to play.
Business leaders are influential, and they are able to then further contribute to society. So if business leaders get inspired to do something good for society, I think it will create a better world.
With presence in over 156 countries, the Art of Living Foundation promises to continue to promote inner peace and well-being for all people.
Some company news now. Hero Lager beer, referred to as the people's favorite drink, has marked its 10th anniversary in Onitsha, the Anambra State capital. well, commercial capital, in a ceremony tagged Kai Woji, meaning let's break the kola knot in Igbo. Officials of international breweries, brand ambassadors, consumers and others gather to celebrate the beer brand. According to the company's marketing director, Mrs. Tolulope Adidiji, Hero is premium beer of quality that not only inspires its consumers, but unites Igbo.
This energetic and refined move by cultural dancers embodies the quality of the Hero Lager Bear as it clocks 10 years. The performance sets the tone for the celebration of one of Nigeria's finest beer brands, Hero Lager, produced by international breweries, and as culture demands, they break the cola nut. The management explains how Hero inspires its consumers with meaningful projects and partnerships.
We supported over 300 Igba boys. We invested over 50 million naira, you know, to support Igba boys to grow their business. We also announced our partnership and support for the NPFL, the Nigerian Professional Football League, for especially clubs in the southeast part of Nigeria, like Enyimba, like Rangers, you know. So we're so excited to be a brand that cares about the consumers, that puts our consumers first, and we're really, really grateful for the love and acceptance that Hero has enjoyed.
I just can't stop going to the, you know, refrigerator to pick a very cold one that suits you for the day. And I can tell you that for me, I think the taste is absolutely smooth.
It's a brand that is a symbol of brotherhood, a symbol of communal gathering. I travel to the communities a lot, and you see when people are doing traditional marriage, when people are doing any kind of events, parties and gathering, you must have to see you.
We will continue to be consistent in giving you superior quality, fresh beer.
As part of the 10-year celebration of the beer brand, a giant Hero Cola Nut is broken symbolically.
The public can taste and to the health of everybody.
For the brand ambassador and the marketing director, Hero Lager Bear has all it takes to retain and attract more consumers.
Before I promote something, I must test it and see the quality therein. And when I have gone through Hero, I find it near perfect, almost perfect. You know, they say nothing is perfect. That is why I am the brand ambassador of Hero Lager.
As it marks its 10th year, the management of Hero Lager Bear says it will continue to innovate and inspire customers to enjoy the premium brand.
Now for some business stories, here's Ann Waldo.
Banking, so easy, so simple. Dial star 894 hash now to experience it. You first, First Bank.
Hello and welcome to Business News. We begin with prices of some essential food items like rice, beans and tomato. They have all increased in the month of July this year, and that's according to latest report coming from the National Bureau of Statistics. The NBS says the average price of 1 kilogram of beans, tomato and rice have shot up by 23.2%, 7.71% and 13.55% when compared to last year. Meanwhile, the Food and Agricultural Organization of the United Nations had earlier this month reported a drop in global food prices in July, the steepest monthly fall in the value of the index since October 2008. Conversations about ease of doing business in Nigeria is still on the forefront, as insecurity, rising inflation, and energy costs continue to plague businesses. The Presidential Enabling Business Environment Council has proposed a 3-year state action on business enabling reforms with a budget of $750 million. According to the special advisor to the president, Dr. Jumoke Oduwole, the federal government will generate 21 million jobs by the year 2025 through the $750 million World Bank SEBA program. Dr. Jumoke was a guest on our Business Morning program today.
The program is going to be a $750 million program for results over the next 3 years, from 2023 to 2025. And what that means is that After states have delivered results, they will get a reimbursement. So the disbursement linked indicators span four areas. Now, the SABR intervention itself, the government SABR envelope, is about $2 billion. And that comes from the aggregation of state expenditure budgets over the next 3 years as captured under the National Development Plan. So at the federal level and at the subnational level, an aggregation of all the interventions and the areas that we hope to work on over the next 3 years and deliver results on is $2 billion. So the SABR program at $750 million comes in at about 36% of that.
Right.
The four areas, the first area would cover about land registration. So the disbursement linked indicator under that is a single one. It has to do with transparency of the process and the structure of getting COOs at the state levels. And the second area has to do with just making sure that we can digitize the economy.
Let's head to the equities market now. We kicked off the first trading day in the week in the lower jaws of the bear as investors sold off stocks of Lafarge and GTCO. Laddie Williams tells us more.
Hello and welcome to the Stock Market Report. Well, the week starts off in the red. Yeah, bearish sentiment from last week still holding on strong in the market. Look at the All Share Index, down 0.05%, 49,346 points. Looks like we're going to be sitting pretty below the 50K level for a while now. Market cap, 26.615 trillion naira. Let's move on to the activity chart there. We see not much buying pressure today. It's mostly red on that counter. Volume traded, 122 million units of stocks, valued at 1.30 billion naira. But we see deals in the green, more deals than what we had on Friday, 3,915 deals. Let's move on now. Let's see the sectoral performance. Banking sector down 0.69%, over half a percent there. We saw sell-offs with stocks from GTCO. Consumer goods up marginally, just 0.07%. We saw Honeywell Flour, there's some buying pressure with that stock. Industrial goods up 0.01%. Let's see who's topping the gainers counter there. Cordville, 48 Cobo, up 9.09%. Honeywell Flour, that pushed up the consumer goods sector there. 2 Naira, 63 Cobo, up 8.68%. Air Benefits also in the top gainers list. Let's see who's topping the losers counter there. FTN Cocoa Processors there, 30 Cobo, down 9.09%. La Sacro, 95 Cobo, down 8% at this time. WAPIC closed down 7.32%. So, looks like the local boss is not immune to the rout in the global equities market we're seeing. Inflation for July came out hot, 19.64%, which could trigger more rate hikes. And we know the equities market doesn't like rate hikes. And that's the Stock Market Report. I'm Laddie Williams. It's back to you.
Thank you, Laddie. As for other major world markets, let's see the numbers for today. And that's business news tonight. Thank you for watching. I'm Anne Nwawadu. The rest of the news continues now with Millicent.
Banking so easy, so simple. Dial *894# now to experience it. You first, First Bank.
Thank you, Anne. There will be no open celebrations marking Ukraine's 31st independence anniversary on Wednesday, as President Volodymyr Zelensky warns of the possibility of intensified attacks from Russian forces. Simon Pusey has more in Around the World in 5.
Good evening and welcome to the channel's studios here in London with your international news Around the World in 5. Ukraine's President Zelensky has warned Russia could do something particularly ugly ahead of independence celebrations. Kyiv officials have banned mass events in the Ukrainian capital, while the northern city of Kharkiv plans a curfew from Tuesday evening. Wednesday marks the 31st anniversary of Ukraine's independence from Soviet rule and 6 months since the start of Russia's invasion. Meanwhile, Russia has accused Ukrainian intelligence officers of organizing the assassination of Darya Dugina, the daughter of one of President Vladimir Putin's top supporters. The FSB, Russia's internal security service, said a Ukrainian citizen who arrived in the country in July was behind the attack on Saturday night. Officers said that the suspect fled Russia into Estonia after Dugina was killed in a car bomb on a road outside Moscow. Ukraine has denied involvement in the attack, and a former Russian MP said yesterday that internal groups opposed to Putin's rule were behind the assassination. Lawyers of Raila Odinga, who came second in Kenya's presidential election, has filed a legal case challenging the result. According to the Electoral Commission, Mr. Odinga took 48.8% of the vote, losing to William Ruto's 50.5%. However, four of the seven electoral commissioners refused to endorse the outcome, alleging that the way the final results were tallied was opaque. The seven judges at the Supreme Court will have 14 days to make a ruling.
The action we have taken is perfectly in line with the stipulations of our Constitution on resolving electoral disputes. It affirms our deep belief in constitutionalism, the rule of law, and a peaceful resolution of disputes, including high-stakes ones like the presidential election.
Scores of supporters of Pakistan's former Prime Minister Imran Khan have gathered outside his hilltop mansion in the capital Islamabad, vowing to prevent his arrest on anti-terrorism accusations. The protesters chanted slogans against the government of Prime Minister Shehbaz Sharif, which took over after Khan's ouster in a confidence vote in April. The move follows a police case filed against Khan on Saturday for threatening government officials in a public speech about the alleged police torture of one of his aides, who faces sedition charges for inciting mutiny in the powerful military. Road bridges around northwestern Mexico have been inundated or damaged by floodwater following heavy rain. Footage shows slow-moving traffic crossing an inundated section of the Douglas Bridge, which links the cities of Empalme and Guimas. High waves from the Sea of Cortez also contributed to the flooding. A section of the Buena Vista Bridge, which is located at the Guimas-Obregón bypass, had collapsed with water seen rushing rapidly beneath it. A new documentary has been released called The Princess to coincide with the 25th anniversary of the death of Diana, the Princess of Wales. Told exclusively through Contemporaneous Archive, creating a bold and immersive narrative of her life and death. It also illuminates how the public's attitude to the monarchy was and still is. The filmmaker behind the show explained why he finds the topic of her life and death so profound.
Diana's death really was a moment where the whole world just seemed to be focused on this singular event. And you know, I vividly remember as an 11-year-old being in my bedroom, and my mum came in very early in the morning and kind of broke the news. And we then kind of gathered around this little TV in my parents' room and sort of watched for the next few hours this sort of unfolding story. And then we also sat for the days and most of the week afterwards and watched tens of thousands of people and then hundreds of thousands of people take to the streets of London. And there was this kind of extraordinary outpouring of grief, this kind of collective wave of emotion.
And finally, over 20 teams have competed in a new game known as water rugby in Switzerland. With a slippery surface, spectators might not be surprised to see players falling into the water, but few perhaps knew that falling in was also intentional. In this five-a-side game of touch rugby, players must jump off the end of the pitch into Lake Geneva to score a try. All players access the pitch by a floating pontoon that moved from the shore to the pitch. The event was organised by Water Rugby Lausanne to celebrate the 50th anniversary of the Lausanne University Rugby Club. And that's your international news around the world in five. Now back to the channel's studios in Lagos.
Thank you, Simon. Welcome to Sports News. Nigerian Professional Football League side Shooting Stars of Ibadan have unveiled Gbenga Ogunbote as their new head coach earlier today. The unveiling ceremony took place at the Lekan Salami Stadium in Ibadan. And the coach replaces Edith Agoye, who has been appointed coach of Sunshine Stars earlier today. The experienced tactician left another NPFL side, Remo Stars, earlier this month after the expiration of his one-year contract. It is the third time Ogunbote will be managing the Oluyole Warriors. Eric Ten Hag has secured his first win as Manchester United manager as goals from Jadon Sancho and Marcus Rashford beat Liverpool 2-1 at Old Trafford this evening. Ten Hag took the bold decision to drop captain Harry Maguire and Cristiano Ronaldo and was rewarded with a perfect performance that lifted the mood of crisis around Manchester United and leave Liverpool still searching for a first win of the season. The Red Devils moved above Liverpool in the table with their first league win over Jurgen Klopp's men since 2018. And Chelsea manager Thomas Tuchel has been charged by the English Football Association with improper conduct for his comments about referee Anthony Taylor after Chelsea's Premier League draw with Tottenham. The Chelsea boss was unhappy with decisions before both Tottenham goals on August the 14th and said after the match that maybe it would be better if Taylor did not referee the Blues again. Tuchel has already been hit with a £35,000 fine and a suspended one-match ban for his touchline confrontation with Spurs boss Antonio Conte at Stamford Bridge. And England women's all-time top goal scorer Ellen White says she is retiring from the game after fulfilling a dream of becoming a European champion last month. White has scored 52 goals for England in 113 appearances since her debut in 2010. She scored twice in England's European Championship campaign last month as the hosts won the title after beating Germany in the final for their first major trophy. And world number two Alexander Zverev has withdrawn from the U.S. Open as he continues his recovery following an ankle surgery. The 25-year-old underwent surgery in June after damaging ligaments in his right ankle during this year's Roland Garros semi-final against Rafael Nadal. The German earlier said that he expected to be back from injury to play for Germany in the Davis Cup in September, but added there was a chance that he could return earlier and feature at Flushing Meadows, where he reached the final in 2020. And that's a wrap on Sports News. It's back to Millicent with the wrap of the news at 10. I'm Victor Mathias. Thank you for watching.
Thank you, Victor. And the main news again. Renowned author Chimamanda Adichie today spoke at the NBA conference in Lagos, where she said Nigerians are starved of heroes whom the citizens could look up to for inspiration. She noted that the country is in disarray and that citizens cannot be safe where the rule of law is absent. That's News at 10 tonight. Thank you for watching. I'm Millicent Walker. Have a good night and stay safe.